Hello, everyone. This lecture will cover the second part of treating the moderately dyspneic patient.
Specifically, we will focus on two major modalities, high-flow nasal cannula and non-invasive positive pressure ventilation.
So to start, what are these devices in general?
These are both methods of providing additional respiratory support one level below intubation. Unlike other methods of delivering oxygen, these devices are unique in that they provide some ventilatory support as well.
So when do we find these modalities useful in clinical practice?
Respiratory support can be thought of in a tiered approach that escalates as the patient's needs change. In general, we progress from room air to nasal cannula to non-rebreather to high-flow nasal cannula or non-invasive positive pressure ventilation, and ultimately to intubation.
I assume we're going to want to frequently check on how our patients are doing and see if they need more support.
Absolutely. As we've discussed before, perform your assessment of the patient's respiratory status, including vital signs, mental status, and work of breathing.
What are some situations where we might go to one of these modalities as a start?
For example, if the patient clearly is working hard to breathe, such as using accessory muscles, unable to speak in a full sentence, they would likely benefit from one of these therapies.
Are there any contraindications to these methods or times where we would skip them altogether and go directly to intubation?
Generally, if a patient has altered mental status and can't protect their airway, or if they have a large amount of secretions, we would recommend intubation.
Okay. So how do we choose between high-flow nasal cannula and non-invasive positive pressure ventilation to support the respiratory needs of suspected COVID patients?
High-flow nasal cannula is preferred for patients in moderate respiratory distress. For example, those breathing at a rate of above 30, but do not appear to be significantly fatigued or using accessory muscles.
When should we start a patient on positive pressure ventilation?
If a patient fails to improve with high-flow nasal cannula, we could consider a trial of non-invasive positive pressure ventilation.
Patients have more severe respiratory distress before starting high flow. For example, if they appear to be fatiguing and using accessory muscles, we'd recommend starting these patients on non-invasive positive pressure ventilation at the beginning. What about provider safety considerations when using these devices?
Ideally, patients on high flow nasal cannula or non-invasive positive pressure ventilation should be placed in a negative pressure room.
And what about personal protective equipment?
Providers that are caring for patients on these devices should be wearing the same equipment that is used for other aerosolizing procedures like intubation. Let's quickly review a high-flow nasal cannula device.
This device looks similar to a traditional nasal cannula, but it has a special nasal fitting that allows several advantages. It delivers heated and humidified oxygen that's more comfortable for the patient.
It also allows a much higher flow rate than usual nasal cannula, up to 50 liters per minute.
In addition, it can deliver a higher percentage of oxygen, up to 100%.
And finally, it can provide a small amount of positive and expiratory pressure. Okay, now that the device is set up, what settings do we start with?
There are two major settings that can be adjusted: flow rate, the amount of oxygen delivered in liters per minute, and the oxygen concentration.
Since the flow appears to help these patients, we recommend placing the patient on a fixed flow of 30 liters per minute.
Once that is set, we recommend starting the oxygen concentration at 100% and decreasing it by 10% at a time to the lowest concentration that they remain comfortable at.
Again, we judge patients' comfort by their work of breathing and respiratory rate.
In terms of a goal oxygen saturation for the patient, we generally target between 92 and 96%. Okay, now let's talk about non-invasive positive pressure ventilation.
These devices provide support by providing positive pressure, similar to a ventilator, but without intubation.
To provide this, the patient wears a face mask or helmet that provides a good seal.
The patient then initiates breaths, and the machine provides varying levels of support. Here are some examples of the helmets and face masks that patients will wear while on this device.
When fitting these devices on the patient, it's important to have a good mask seal for both patient comfort and to ensure proper ventilation.
There are two major categories of non-invasive positive pressure ventilation: continuous positive pressure ventilation, or CPAP, and bi-level positive pressure ventilation, or BiPAP.
These devices provide support oxygenation with oxygen delivery up to 100% and positive end expiratory pressure.
The difference between continuous positive pressure ventilation and bi-level positive pressure ventilation is that bi-level ventilation provides inspiratory pressure.
For the purposes of this talk, we'll primarily be discussing how to manage bi-level positive pressure ventilation, as it's more helpful for providing ventilatory support. Let's talk more about bi-level positive pressure ventilation. This device provides continuous pressure that helps stent open the airways. That's called positive end expiratory pressure. It also provides additional support when a patient takes a breath. This is the inspiratory pressure.
This helps to minimize their work of breathing, which is helpful in fatiguing patients.
There are three parameters that are set on these devices. These are inspiratory pressure, positive end expiratory pressure, and oxygen concentration. We mentioned the parameters that providers can set on these devices. What are some good settings to start with?
So the provider will set positive end expiratory pressure and inspiratory pressure. These are normally reported in centimeters of water as inspiratory pressure over positive end expiratory pressure.
For example, this machine shows a setting of 10 over 5, which represents 10 centimeters of inspiratory pressure and 5 centimeters of water of positive end expiratory pressure.
This means the patient will constantly receive 5 centimeters of water of end expiratory pressure. When they take a breath in, they receive an additional 10 centimeters of pressure support.
Once the inspiratory and positive end expiratory pressure is set, the provider then sets the oxygen concentration. Here it's set to 21%, but it's usually best to start at 100% and titrate down to the minimum amount required. As with all of the methods of respiratory support we've discussed, the patient needs to be frequently reassessed for adjustments.
Consider the patient's work of breathing, as well as markers of their oxygenation and ventilation, like their oxygen saturation and carbon dioxide levels.
In general, ventilation should be assessed first. If a patient appears to have increased work of breathing, increased respiratory rate, or rising levels of carbon dioxide, they require more support and the provider should increase the inspiratory pressure.
Generally, we recommend titrating by 2 to 3 centimeters of water and reassessing the ventilation.
If the patient does not appear to have increased work of breathing and has normal carbon dioxide levels, but has a low oxygen saturation, the provider needs to improve their oxygenation.
To do this, the provider should increase either the oxygen concentration or level of positive end expiratory pressure. Generally, it's better to increase the oxygen concentration first, as the risk of damage to the lungs or aspiration is higher with higher levels of positive end expiratory pressure.
When adjusting the pressure on these devices, the total pressure, that is the inspiratory pressure plus the positive end expiratory pressure, should not exceed 20 centimeters of water, as the risk of aspiration increases above this level. Okay, now for some final points.
Respiratory support can be seen as an escalating ladder with several options before intubation.
Both high-flow nasal cannula and non-invasive positive pressure ventilation are options for patients with severe dyspnea prior to intubation.
High-flow nasal cannula is preferred, with non-invasive positive pressure ventilation as the next best option.
Whatever modality you use, reassessment and titration of these modalities is important, as well as determining whether the patient ultimately requires intubation.